Welcome to the very first installment of the Miami History Podcast. My name is Casey Paquette. I'm a blogger on Miami History at miami-history.com, also a co-founder for the Miami History Channel. And I would say that Miami's history is a passion of mine. My family goes way back to 1899. And as I've learned about my family, I've learned about Miami. And in particular, with the help of the very esteemed historian, Dr. Paul George. Paul, do you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, delighted to be here, Casey. Paul George, a native Miamian, kind of rare. Been dealing in Miami history for more than 40 years and loving it, every minute of it. I've taught many places, including Miami-Dade College for 26 years. And among the classes I taught was Miami South Florida History and Florida History, and enjoyed them immensely. Have written widely about these topics. I'm presently a resident historian at History of Miami, and I've worked with History of Miami now for 30 years and have enjoyed that a lot, too, conducting tours and providing talks and a lot of writing projects, and I'm happy to be here with you today.
Yeah, one thing that, Paul, you left off is that you are also a co-founder of the Miami History Channel.
Well, you're right.
And I would say that it probably requires a little definition on what that project is. I got to know Paul in about 2011, 2012 time frame, and one thing that became very clear to me is that Paul has a tremendous amount of really good knowledge on Miami's history. Some of it has been written in some of his books. Some of it is more or less just oral history. So I thought it would be good to have Paul across a variety of different topics talk about Miami's history. As he narrates, I produce videos that include images and moving picture to complement what he's talking about, and that's really the genesis of the project for the Miami History Channel. You can reach the Miami History Channel at miamihc.com. It is a membership site. However, the membership fee is very nominal. It's $29.95 for the entire year. And it's something that that Paul and I feel strongly about because we're really capturing this great tacit knowledge about Miami's history through somebody that's been an historian in Miami, somebody who's conducted tours for many, many years in the area. So we encourage any of you to go check it out. We do have free previews for many of our episodes. We'll produce other things, including this podcast, to talk about Miami's history to evangelize. So why have we put together a podcast? We've got the Miami History Channel. Paul does a lot of writing. He does tours. The purpose of the podcast is really to extend the reach, to provide education on topics that aren't always covered in tours and in books. And where we're going to begin is to talk about some of Miami's pioneers. We're going to start with Henry Flagler, talk about the father of Miami, talk about Julia Tuttle, the mother of Miami, and then the Brickles as our kickoff of topics. So this particular podcast is going to focus on Henry Flagler. Actually, the first two are. We're going to divide it up into two parts. The format of the podcast, at least to start, will be I will ask Paul five questions to help build out who the individual, the event, or the place is that we're going to talk about for the specific episode. So let's go ahead and get started with the questions on Henry Flagler. A lot of people may be familiar with Flagler Street. I would say maybe even a lot of people are very familiar with Henry Flagler that are listening to this podcast right now. What we wanted to do is we wanted to ask a set of questions that would give the uninitiated, the people that don't know anything about Flagler, a little bit of idea of who the man was and what brought him to Florida, and in particular, what brought him to South Florida to found a town in conjunction with others. So the very first question that I have for Paul is, Paul, can you talk a little bit about Henry Flagler's background, his history, before he came to Florida?
Well, he was born in New York in 1830, and I would say he was born in a poverty, but he was, you know, fairly impoverished, so much so that when he was young, he vowed that once he rose out of poverty through work, he would never be poor again, and he stuck very closely to that vow throughout his life and, of course, built great wealth through Standard Oil, among other things. So he, as a young entrepreneur, he moved to Ohio where there were some opportunities with a relative and had a store, shop. And eventually, in the mid-1860s, right after the Civil War, he became a co-founder with John D. Rockefeller and another person by the last name of Andrews of what became Standard Oil. And that would become among the world's greatest and largest corporations. And from that, he derived a lot of wealth. And he contributed mightily to its success.
So, Paul, Henry Flagler, at the time that he was working in Standard Oil, he, of course, a lot of people said he was the chief negotiator, but he was also the lightning rod for the Department of Justice. And as he was clashing with the Department of Justice, he was brought frequently in front of Congress. He decided that he was going to retire at a young age. Can you talk a little bit about after his retirement from Standard Oil, what brought him to Florida?
Well, he retired a wealthy man. He was a millionaire. He retired in the late 1870s. His first wife, a beloved lady by the name of Mary Flagler, was ill, had been ill through much of her life, and he was advised, and she was advised by their doctors in New York. By then, Standard Oil was headquartered in New York, to get out of this bitter cold winter of 1877-78. And so he brought her down to St. Augustine, ultimately, Jacksonville, St. Augustine, for better weather. Nobody went much farther south than that. There wasn't anything developed any farther south than that other than Key West, which was way down there. And she felt better, but ultimately, she relapsed and died in 1879, and he was really grief-stricken, and nothing really seemed important to him at that point, especially Standard Oil, even though he had a lot of investment in the company. And he began to do other things, and had really been, I think, touched by and smitten by Northeast Florida, so he decided to come back there again, and he did in the early 1880s. And this time, I think he saw it in a different vein. It wasn't so much to enhance the health of an ailing wife who had now passed, but for investment opportunities, for developmental opportunities. And so this would bring him into the area. He was good friends with a man named Henry Plant, a Connecticut Yankee, who was a very successful businessman also, building a railroad system in western Florida. And I think through his contacts with Plant, he began to get the idea that maybe he could do something for the east coast of Florida, which was really woefully undeveloped, like Plant was doing for part of the west coast of Florida in terms of railroad development, hotel development, city development, harbor development, and those kinds of things.
So, Paul, you actually already started to answer question number three, because a very maybe not so well-known fact about Flagler is that he did have this friendship with Henry Plant. Henry Plant did develop the west coast of Florida, and the two of them really had the same vision. It's extend the railway, build a nice luxury resort, and then extend it even further. How much of that would you say was really a master plan on Flagler's part, or more just a opportunistic situation where he felt that, you know, the further south that he went, the further he went away from winter?
Well, I think that he did have in the back of his mind an ultimate goal of extending that railroad as far south as he could move it, which would be to Key West. But I also think that he was practical enough to understand that as long as he had the financial backing, that he would move it incrementally south. And so we spread this out over a long period of time. He would buy a small railroad line between Jacksonville and St. Augustine in the 1880s, and it wouldn't be until 1912 that railroad, by then known as the Florida East Coast Railway, was already was all the way down to Key West. So I think it was both kind of an informal master plan, but also an ad hoc kind of a thing. Let's just see how it goes. We're going to take it down to Ormond Beach. We're going to take it down to Hypoluxo. We're going to take it down to West Palm Beach. Let's see how it goes at each of these places. He was that type of a practical businessman.
And, of course, once he was in Palm Beach, there was, you know, a lot of talk that that's as far as he really wanted to go. Maybe he had an eye on Key West, but he wasn't thinking about going any further. However, he was contacted frequently by a woman who owned land along the north bank of the Miami River, Julia Tuttle. And things seemed to have changed in 1894 and 1895 when there were some very harsh winters that extended all the way south of Palm Beach. At that time, he then commissioned or asked his one of his top lieutenants, James Ingram, to go out and take a look at the scope and the reach of the freeze. Can you talk a little bit about what happened as Ingram had went down to Miami ultimately to figure out if the freezes had reached the mouth of the Miami River?
Well, Ingram knew Julia Tuttle, the future mom of Miami, through a Cleveland connection, church and otherwise. And Flagler was aware of Julia Tuttle because she had sent him messages by mail asking him to consider moving his railroad to the Miami River in exchange for some really choice land that she possessed, which represents much of today's downtown Miami. Ingram did go down to the Miami River, did meet with Julia Tuttle, did bring back, and this is his own testimony in 1920 before the Miami Woman's Club, some undamaged orange blossoms, evidence that Miami was not hit by these severe freezes on Christmas Eve of 1894 and early February of 1895, which meant that it was a land where virtually year-round you could grow crops, or it was a land where, at least in the winter season, you could host a lot of tourists. And that was an ideal situation for a guy who was a railroad magnate, but it was also building some great hotels, one in Ormond Beach. He had two he built in St. Augustine, one he bought in St. Augustine. And then, of course, in Palm Beach, he had a couple of great hotels. So it all looked good for Flagler at this point, and this would be early 1895.
Yeah, so thank you, Paul. And as we mentioned, this is going to be a two-part podcast on Henry Flagler. We're going to leave off exactly where the freezes took place and brought Flagler down to begin serious discussions with not only Julia Tuttle, but also the Brickles, who both will be featured in upcoming podcast. So I want to thank you, Paul, for answering these questions and providing education around Henry Flagler and his role in Florida. The next podcast, like I said, will cover the second part to Henry Flagler's journey down through South Florida and ultimately to Key West. So thank you very much for listening. And we do once again encourage you to check out the Miami History Channel. It takes topics like these into a lot more depth, but it also provides imagery, pictures, motion picture around some of the topics. And Paul, the first set of episodes actually focus on your South Florida history course. So they're broken up into episodes by decades and focus on really Miami's history through the years dating back over 2,000 years ago. So we encourage everybody to at least check it out. There's no charge to look at the free episodes, the free previews. If you decide to join, it's simply $29.95 for an entire year, unlimited access to a library of, Paul, believe it or not, we're up to 18 episodes.
That's terrific. It's such a great resource, really is. And I really encourage folks to jump in on that. It's a great way to learn and even see, because of so many great visual illustrations, Miami's history, both chronologically and topically.
So thank you, Paul. We look forward to hopefully having you rejoin us for future episodes or future podcasts on Miami history. Thank you, and we will provide links into the podcast description area for where you can check out the Miami History Channel and some of the other resources, particularly around Flagler. So thank you, and look forward to talking to or having you listen soon. Thank you.
Thank you.